Jim Feist Pro Football Handicapping Show. My name is Tommy Canella. I will be the moderator for the show today, and sitting to my right is a man who really doesn't need any introduction. Been around this business a whole lot of years. We'll just put it there.
Easy on that.
Jim Feist, and we've now turned the calendar from November into December.
Yes.
Which means Don DeMarcus, who has great food and drinks, pizzeria and wine bar, now has holiday cocktail menu. Let me give you a couple of these. The Jingle Juice, Captain Morgan's, some chartreuse, simple syrup, and lime juice. You want to do a little Jingle Juice with me? Or are you more into like Elf Secret Stash?
Well, I'm afraid to say yes because I have no idea what's in it.
Okay. Elf Secret Stash, vodka, Grey Goose vodka, Kahlua, and some espresso. Or we do the Jingle Juice.
I'd take one drink of that and you'd have to carry me out of here.
That's perfect. Go to the show notes, check out Dom DeMarcus, get here and check out their cocktail menu, their happy hour from 2 to 6, Monday through Friday, every single week, every Monday through Friday, 50% off of pizzas, 50% off of wines from 2 to 6, pizzas just 2 to 4. We always talk about how good the food is. I want to go to a food day with you first before we introduce our panel, which was Thanksgiving, which recently happened. You and I text on this, so I thought this would be a great way to open this show. How bad was that debacle at the end of the Bears-Lions game?
Well, it cost the guy his job, but he should have never been hired in the first place.
Okay.
Bad coach, it was a bad hire. Didn't qualify to be that. That was horrible. They should have fired him before he got on the bus.
I thought they should have fired him before he got to the locker room. You know what I mean? They should have had somebody in the – I've seen that happen in college basketball. They get fired in the tunnel, so they should have fired the guy. But let me ask you this, because I've had some people reach out to me and say – okay, bad coaching decision, but how much of that really lies on Caleb Williams to know what's going on?
A lot, and that's the question. A lot of people said, coming out of college, does he have it between the ears to make good decisions, you know, on the fly? And obviously, as the quarterback, he's in charge when he's on the field. I mean, you don't call the kind of play that he called. He changed the play to do that. And I mean, that was ridiculous. Yes, he needs to mature. I hope he does. He has the arm talent. I mean, I was listening to Cosell about it. He said his arm is just as good as anybody. He can throw stuff. You know, it's unbelievable what he can do with the arm.
We'll get more into the Bears and their matchup this week. But let's introduce the panel. We have two new guys joining us. First, Bernie Fratto. He can be heard on Fox Sports Radio, the author of The View from the Cheap Seats. And he's held media credentials with the Tigers, the Pistons, the Lions for many years. Bernie, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, and it brings back memories of the old Pro Line days in the 90s. I haven't come to Vegas in 79. And what's really great is back then, as you know, gambling wasn't legal, right? Only in Vegas.
Well, did that matter?
Of course not. Of course not. Everybody gambled anyway. There's a story about the recruit that went to Notre Dame, star linebacker recruit. And they said, why don't we bring him in the locker room before the game and he can get all fired up with the team? So Father Hesbert leads the team in prayer. And the team's all fired up and they run out the tunnel and the recruit looks at Father Hesbert and says, Father, does that really help praying before a game? He goes, I hope so, son. We're laying 7.5 today.
Also with us at the end of the table, a sports handicapper, blogger, professional sports bettor, radio personality, and a very successful NBA guy, Aaron Redding. Aaron, welcome to the show.
Hey, good to be with you guys. I finally get a chance to meet Jim. I've been out in Las Vegas well over 20 years now. First time to ever do a show with him. And I don't do a lot of media anymore, so good to be with you guys.
Glad to have you here. Thank you.
Let me throw something out, you guys, and I don't care who wants to take it down the panel. The Chargers defense, is it, I mean, let me back up. We know it's legit. Is it good enough to get them deep into a playoff run?
I'll go ahead. I mean, I think it is. I mean, the one thing you have to remember is they've been a little bit banged up as well. Bosa was very limited in the snaps that he was playing for, you know, a good 4 to 6 weeks. Same thing with Mac. The bigger question for me is definitely that offense. Do they have some playmakers, some legitimate guys that can step up and score and make plays against, you know, some of these better teams that seem to have no problem scoring, like the Ravens?
You know, they always say defense wins championships, but I agree. Do they have enough offense to carry them deep? Bernie, what do you think?
I don't think so. I think they're one and done, especially if they have to travel back into weather. Jim Harbaugh covered him in Michigan. He'll be very Simon Sound with his defense. They're a couple of players away from competing against a playoff team on the road to win a game of that nature.
Now, this week, Humphreys is coming back at left tackle for the Chiefs, and Pacheco's coming back at running back. That's going to really help the Chiefs. And they have been taking off in the games and getting big leads and then just letting it fly. And the last two games, they ended up like winning by 3 or 2, and should have been more. But now you've got the Chargers coming in here, division rival, only catching a couple. And the wide receiver that Herbert throws to the most successfully, he is supposed to be out.
Ladd McConkey?
Yes. McConkey, right? Yes. I mean, and he was getting, the efficiency from that passing duo was 53%. That's way higher than anybody else on the team.
Is that line still 4 against the Chiefs this week?
I haven't looked at it in the last couple hours.
Yeah, the last I saw was 4, and then Dobbins, the running back, is out too. So they have a void of playmakers.
That's the bigger loss. Well, the other issue, you mentioned Isaiah Pacheco. He's a punisher. Football is a game of attrition. I expect Kansas City to be run heavy. They'll wear that defense down. I'm not involved in the game, but I wouldn't want to grab. I don't know. I don't know if the Chargers will hang that number. I think in the third, fourth quarter, the Chiefs will exert their will.
I believe so too.
Jimmy, are you on this game?
Well, you know, originally when I looked at it, I said, taking 4 with, but then when I looked at the injuries and the players coming back for the other side, there's no way. I have to be on the Chiefs.
I thought the number would be a little bit higher. I came in hoping to maybe play the Chargers, but I thought that was a little bit cheap. And you know, it kind of where it does power rate, because Kansas City hasn't blown any team away.
Right.
But they know how to win. And you know, a team that certainly knows how to win, hard to bet against at that number.
Let me throw another team out. Jim, we did a podcast where we started this weekly show with the beginning of the season, and we talked about the Pittsburgh Steelers being a team that has the worst schedule coming down the stretch, which they're starting to get into. They are showing some resilience. Can they maintain this resilience? They got Cleveland. Last time I saw it was 6.5 this week. But can they hang on to this deep schedule, this hard schedule, and get past this or no?
Absolutely, yes. The reason is Tomlin.
Okay.
He's a great coach. He doesn't lose often. He's got a great defense. They don't turn the ball over. They can run the ball. And what the hell happened to Russell Wilson? He's reborn. I mean, granted, he played a high school defense last week, threw up 40 points against the Bengals, but the Bengals bengal everybody. I mean, their offense is unstoppable, but their defense can't stop anyone. This week, they're going to face Jameis Winston, who is the most exciting player in the world. He will score for both teams. He's very excited. You're going to get a lot of action just watching this guy. But I love the guy. He's so enthusiastic. The players love him. Everybody loves to play. But the problem is he can't win just consistently. But 2 weeks ago, they did win in the snow in Cleveland. So what do we have? We have one week away from it. We have a revenge game with Tom. I mean, it's going to be very hard for Cleveland to go in there and beat the Steelers.
Crack, is it up to 7 now?
Pretty solid 7, dog 20. A couple 6.5s here. South Point 6.5, DraftKings 6.5.
Do you like the game, Jim?
I do. And if the weather's good, I like it over.
Okay.
Because, you know Jameis is going to score for both teams. And, you know, Russell Wilson, wherever, 3 years, I mean, 2 years at the end of his career in Seattle. And then with Denver, it was horrible. Now, all of a sudden, he runs into Tomlin and gets all back. He's playing well. He doesn't turn the ball over. He still can throw the deep ball. And somehow he's not as fast or quick as never. He went never fast, but he was kind of quick in the pocket, and he could avoid the hits. This is going to be an interesting game. I like the Steelers. I like the over more than the Steelers, but I like both.
Bernie or Aaron?
I love the Steelers. First of all, Russell Wilson threw 25 touchdowns last year against 8 picks. Sean Payton just hated him. I love that you brought up Jameis. You can have him. Look, if I had a
does
nickel,
anybody want him?
If I had a nickel for every time Jameis threw a pick six, Elon Musk would be mowing my lawn. Pittsburgh hosting Cleveland. The last 21 times that Cleveland has visited Pittsburgh, they're 1-20 straight up, 4-16 against the spread. It's Pittsburgh or nothing for me. I love their DNA. Jameis is 2-3 as a starter, and they're acting like he's the next coming of Johnny Unitas. You can have the guy. He's a 30-for-30 man, okay? The year he threw 30 picks, he completely kept Tampa Bay out of the playoffs. 6 of them were in the first drive.
Oh,
six
I know
of them
that.
Were in the fourth quarter. 6 of them were pick sixes when they had the lead. Aaron, you got the floor.
Yeah, Jim, I'm with you as far as the over. I've been riding the over with the Cleveland Browns. And you know, there's no question with Jameis. He's a rare unicorn that creates offense for both teams. And when I adjusted Cleveland, their power rating, I made their defense worse when Winston came in. You have to account for that and know that ahead of time.
How about the defense on the road?
And be proactive while you were doing it. And then there were some other things that were coming together as far as, obviously, Deshaun Watson, you know, the worst quarterback we had essentially seen for a veteran type of player. The offensive line was an absolute mess for the Browns to start the year. But they were able to get healthier, and they have talent on that. And then we've also seen we have a quarterback that can actually throw the ball. They have talented tight end. They have a talented wide receivers, guys who can score. So it's been great in that effect with it. And then also with the Steelers, I don't know if there's hardly a better team from a defensive standpoint that forces turnovers. So that, you know, again, so Pittsburgh's defense, probably you'll see a lot of tickets from last Monday where teams were betting over two defensive touchdowns from Denver. It's some big prices and there's cash. So, I mean, yeah, if you're betting props, you probably want to look for a defensive score here for the Pittsburgh Steelers.
Hey, as a Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
Everybody always complains about bad beats, but I had a bad win. I covered with Denver last week. I should have never covered with that game. I mean, normally you lose those kind, but that one, they gave it to me.
The rules state they must cash that ticket, Jim.
That's right.
You owe no one apologies.
And I didn't tear it up.
I agree with you guys. I mean, as a Tampa Bay Buccaneers fan, I was never so happy to see him leave and go somewhere else. Aaron, let me start with you at that side of the table and bring it this way. Before I get into tonight's matchup with Detroit and Green Bay, is Philadelphia there or past Detroit is the best NFC team right now?
I have them power rated ahead of Detroit right
you do.
Now. I do a couple sets of power ratings, but I really like, you know, as we get close to ending the year and into the playoffs, I really look for teams that can control the ball on both lines of the scrimmage. And, you know, you have a Super Bowl contender if you can do that. Obviously, it helps to have a good quarterback as well. But the Eagles, if you watch them, they are dominating the line of scrimmage on both sides. You know, Carter and this defense have been wrecking teams, the offensive line as well. So they have shot up. You know, I like the fact that the offensive line went to the head coach during the bye, said, hey, we want to run the ball. And that's what they've been able to do. And the defense has come on now, so I have moved them past. And, you know, and Detroit's very good, obviously, but they won it a little bit fluky nature and ran up the score a little bit. So, you know, defensive weaknesses, the loss of Hutchinson. Bernie can talk a little bit more about Detroit, probably better than I can. But there's a little bit more weakness there now.
Bernie, how much is the injuries piling up for Detroit?
Very much so, and I agree with everything you said about Philadelphia. I honestly think you can put them on a neutral right now. Did you make Philly 1-2?
Yeah, I have them. Yeah.
So to answer your point directly, I'm still very plugged in Detroit. Spent 17 years in the media there. Did Lions pre and post for 10 years. They lost Malcolm Rodriguez last week. He's a spy. He's the type of guy that could follow Jalen Hurts around the field. That's a problem. If you notice the second half of the Bears game last week, they magically moved the ball. Not because Caleb Williams figured out how to play, because the pass rush was not getting home. And if you give a guy a major league quarterback time, they're going to move the ball. That was a scary win for Detroit. Yes, the injuries are piling up. Yes, there is concern. That doesn't mean the Lions can't still prevail, but it's going to be a much more difficult task down the road. As long as they get playoff games at home, the main team they got to worry about is Philadelphia, but they are no means a lock to get to the Super Bowl.
Philadelphia usually starts the game out slow in the first half, but in the second half, their physicality from running the ball, and they're just a physical team, they wear you down. And at the end of the game, you're just toast against them. And a couple of weeks ago, I said Detroit was probably better, but Philadelphia just started to play so much better now. They are the team in the NFC that should go to the Super Bowl. Now, granted, there's still five more weeks to go,
right,
and injuries can happen, and usually they do. So hopefully that doesn't happen to them, and they could be in the championship game, likely against Detroit. I don't know who else. If Detroit falls off bad enough, who would be the next
maybe
team?
Green Bay, maybe Minnesota. I don't think anybody from the West or the South.
Okay. Speaking of Green Bay, let's talk about tonight's game with Detroit at Green Bay. Last time I looked, it was 3.5 and 51.5. Do you like this game tonight? And if so, what do you like about it?
You're asking me?
Yeah.
I like Green Bay to win the game straight up, and it's going to come. Last year he started to play better later in the season. Now we're down to that point. He's starting to get better. I think the defense for injuries for Detroit are going to hurt. They're going to give Love a little bit more opportunity, and it's going to come down to one guy. Watkins has got to find out how to hold the ball. He drops too many passes. If he holds on to these passes, he's going to get open. He's going to have time to get the ball. If he holds on to it, they're going to win the game straight up.
Okay.
You're talking about Christian Watson, right?
What? Watson, Sue.
Watson, I need you.
Bernie, like being a Detroit guy, you like Green Bay tonight, or you like
Detroit?
Well,
I would lean with Jim.
Okay.
I didn't fire on the game on the side. You might think I'm crazy. I actually, at 51.5, I played half a unit on the under. You got two divisional teams. After November 1st, the total is more than 45. The last 8 years, it's been about a 70% trend for me. Now, I know the game's inside. I look for Josh Jacobs and Jahmyr Gibbs to both. I think you're going to see run heavy on both sides to start and establish the line of scrimmage. Watson can take the top off of defense. And I think you're going to see Green Bay is underrated. They've got 7 first-round draft choices on defense, and they're all getting into their mid-late 20s right now. And I'm not making a prediction on tonight's game because it's a coin flip game. But I got to tell you, I might lean with Jim, and we'll just see what happens.
What about you, Aaron?
I bet just about every single NFL game, certainly about 75%. I don't have a bet on this game.
Okay.
Just because it's a big game, marquee game, Thursday night game, doesn't mean I'm going to bet it. A couple of things I'll say with this. When they met about a month ago in Green Bay, though, the weather was horrific. A lot of people said, Detroit, beat them up really good and won that game going away. It wasn't true. Green Bay averaged Green Bay had about over 400 yards of offense in that game. Detroit only had about 260, 270. I think it was like 6.6 yards per play to 4 something for Green Bay. So I think you have to keep that in mind. I think it was 10-3. Love threw that horrific interception where Detroit returned it for a touchdown right before the half. That was essentially the game with the weather conditions in that game. So you have to keep that in mind. And, I thought Bernie was right as far as Green Bay. Well, DJ Reader's out for Detroit in this game, a big-time run stop for the Detroit Lions. So Green Bay will run, and boy, that play action passing game for Green Bay when they get rolling with the run game, very difficult to stop. With that said, the first time they met and Detroit won going away, the Lions were favored by about a field goal at Green Bay.
Great point.
So, to come back at home and you could lay 3 with Detroit, I don't know if there's value with taking Green Bay in this game. So I'm just going to sit it out.
Ray, you're chomping at the bit there on the other side, so you must have some words
to
say about this game.
Who they got Jordan Love? They're great. They're 12th. They're 12th. They're not overrated. They're not underrated. They're 12th.
You're not a Green Bay fan.
You guys already said it. This is the way it is. This is the way it is. Detroit's gonna knock them off tonight. I don't know about how much. Maybe 12. They're gonna.
You're saying double digits.
Here's what I'm saying.
Are you sprinkling a little Detroit in double digits?
Here's what I'm saying. Green Bay's top heavy with Jordan. I'm sorry. Penny Sewell, household name on the line. He's still there. This whole 5 weeks. So here's what I've been hearing. Detroit's are finding new ways to beat people. He threw 5 interceptions and they still won the game. They're eating kneecaps. And then now it comes to a divisional game. Oh. I think they're injured. I don't think they have what it takes. This is, you guys already said it. Caesars has them to win it all at plus 235. Philadelphia is a little bit better right now. Here's what I'm saying. Whoever you like, bet it today. Because if Green Bay does knock them off, what do you think those futures are?
If you like Detroit to win the Super Bowl, you might as well just wait till the playoffs start and get a mechanical parlay.
Absolutely.
1, 2, 3, boom, and you'll get better odds.
He doesn't know that. Little Philly this morning. Here's what I like. And I already said it before. I like Detroit and Buffalo to win the conference on a 2-teamer plus 648. Then Super Bowl MVP, Jalen Hurts and Patrick Mahomes and whoever at 22-1. And then hopefully you don't get knocked off.
Well, you just guaranteed yourself at least 2 losers with that parlay there.
You did.
But it's about that can't all happen. What are you doing, my man? You're a smart guy. Guy went to Penn Quaker for crying out loud. I went to Cal State Fullerton for 2 terms, Carters and Reagans.
Right. So who do you like tonight on the money line? Green Bay or Detroit?
I'm not Oh, it's on TV. I must bet it, right?
No.
I'm not firing on the side. You may well be right, Tom. Okay. I like the under for half a unit. That's it. Good night, folks.
Yeah. Let's switch gears. We talked about Detroit and Philly being the two top teams in the NFC. Let's talk about Philadelphia at home this week versus the Panthers. Double-digit laying.
My favorite game of the week.
I mean, I've heard this a couple times now. Laying double digits is not good in the NFL. Is Philadelphia good enough to cover 12 and a half?
Well, they're good enough to. Will they show up to do it? That's the question. And, you know, Carolina's starting to play a little bit better. But this man just said, I love this game. I'm going to let him talk.
Go ahead, Bernie.
Well, and I'll defer to the two guys, extremely bright, successful guys. Look, Philadelphia, you're going to pay a Philadelphia tax from here on out, I believe. Is that fair? So they're laying 12 and a half. Let me just get to my point. The last nine games, Philadelphia's laid double digits or 1-8 against the number. They're laying 12 and a half against a spunky Carolina team who's covered four in a row. Got NFL players over there. And guess who Philadelphia plays next week? Now, I'm not one of these sandwich guys games. I don't know if people eat a sandwich, what the hell they do. But they play Pittsburgh next week, a big-time in-state rival. They're going to get in, get out, nobody get hurt, win that game. I think Carolina, I think they hang the 12 and a half. That's my play of the week.
Aaron?
Very good. I did not bet the side in this game. I think the one thing you also have to mention is Philadelphia is really banged up. And you would expect them to probably sit a lot of those guys. Slay and Blankenship probably not going to play here. They have some injuries on the offensive as well. So with that said, from a power rating perspective, I said I had the Eagles the top team. I had the Carolina certainly the bottom team. And last week with the Panthers, and you know, talked about how Bryce Young is getting better. You know, we'll see. I'm not sold on that. Tampa, you know, the Buccaneers are not a good running team. They ran for almost 300 yards last week. So I don't know what Barkley and the Eagles are going to do in this game. But with that said, I bet it over the total. I bet a lot of totals. And, you know, Bryce Young is getting better. You have some injuries in the secondary for the Eagles. So, you know, I think Carolina can definitely score in this game. The Eagles, they're going to be hard to stop with that run game here. So, 45, 46 crack over the total in this game for me.
Crack, you're out there. You like this game at all?
You know, it's amazing. The pros, I have never heard more pros ever this week laying double digits in life.
Really? I've heard it the other way around, though.
Really? Because yeah. I know I listen to, I only respect a couple guys in the NFL, you being one of them. I've heard Steve Fezzik give it out on his show, minus 12, 12 and a half. Las Vegas Chris gave it out.
Wow.
A lot of guys are betting. I can't ever lay double digits right. in the Very NFL. Difficult. Ever. I don't think I've ever done it in my life. So I can't back Philadelphia. I can't
look
back
Nick Sirianni's history laying double digits.
Yeah. Oh,
it's just throwing it out there.
Well, the point brought up with the banged up players on Philadelphia would make sense that they would slow down, sit down some players. And you know that even though the Panthers are one of the worst teams, they have been playing a little bit better, and they haven't quit. I mean, the Giants are—they quit. They're not doing anything. But the Panthers are playing.
And to Bernie's point too, also maybe a little bit of a look ahead, and maybe
easily.
Blankenship.
Yes.
Maybe these guys are going to be take a little bit step.
Let's
back.
Say you're holding a ticket, and it's 28-10 with 6 minutes to go, and Carolina's got the ball.
Yeah.
Don't think they like to punch one in and hang that back door.
Jacksonville, Philly, a couple weeks ago.
Perfect example. That was a double-digit line.
Yeah, and they were handily winning the game going into the fourth quarter, and they let
get Pittsburgh on deck next week. Right. Just a thought.
Yeah. And another thing with this game, and Jim, I know you like kind of not exactly situations, but trends and etc. You know, I used to chart this in first-year NFL head coaches. You know, where they start out poorly, they can't make the playoffs, but they continue to play and fight. They've been very good against the spread down the stretch. And the Panthers kind of fit that profile of a hard-trying team, buying into their head coach and kind of improving as the year goes on.
Top credit. Dave Canales was presiding over in Seattle over Russell Wilson when they had their great seasons and finished strong. Tampa Bay last year, when they finished strong. I think Dave Canales can really coach, and I think this team is improving.
Let me ask you guys this. The weather was terrible for the Buffalo 49ers game. But looking back at that, how much did that maybe spring forward the Bills. Did that game, I mean, I know it's a banged up 49ers team, but the way they acted, it was almost like it was this springboard for them forward. Like, this was a game they had to have. This was a game they needed to prove themselves that they're legit. And now we're going this week to the Rams. I mean, what do you think about this, Jim?
Well, there's no question. I mean, they were playing a Super Bowl team. And, a pretty regular Super Bowl team. But it's not the same team. The Niners are really toast. I think if you just put a fork in them, they're done. And that's why I'm picking the Bears to win the game straight up, even though I have a rookie quarterback and a new coach. But, yes, I think it's very easy for Buffalo to be overrated in this game because of who they have next and down the road. They want to be number one, get that number one seed, play the championship game in Buffalo, but so does Kansas City. And people don't talk about that. They keep saying, oh, they got to win. They want to be in Buffalo. Well, Kansas City is doing the same thing. They have the same motivation. The Rams played terrible against Miami, and they played terrible against Philadelphia, and now they're back home again. And I like the Rams, but I just, God, can they get the? They're not physically as good as these other teams they're playing, and this is the third straight home game against a very good team. But this is a great spot for the Bills to have a letdown, and the Rams are desperate. I mean, they got Arizona and they got Seattle ahead of them in that division. And if they lose this game, they're probably toast for the playoffs.
I'll have to say, if you've been betting Buffalo to have a letdown, I mentioned it, Detroit as well, you've been losing money because it just hasn't happened. The Bills have showed up just about every single week and played well. You know, the one game at Baltimore where they've gotten blown out. But you're right, you kind of wait for it and you expect the ebb and flow of the NFL. Hasn't really happened. I think the crowd will be about half Buffalo here.
Probably.
They'll travel really well. I did not bet the side. I bet this game over the total as well. I mean, Allen at this point can do just about anything he wants offensively, running, throwing the ball. His receivers are getting better as well. And yeah, the Rams have to know with McVay that they're going to have to need to score some points here, and they're capable as well with Stafford their wide receivers as well. So it's a game I bet over.
Stafford has a little bit of an ankle problem. Not sure how terrible it is. He's going to play, but it's curtailed his practice this week. They've talked about it. The one thing that the Rams have to do in this game to stay in it, they can't get in the shootout with this team. They're going to have to run the ball and control it. And if that running game works, it'll open up Stafford, give him a little bit more time to hit the wide receivers. And we know they have really good wide receivers. So that's kind of what I'm looking at here and giving them a chance to do it. They're not as good. We know that. Mm-hmm.
I think Buffalo might be the most complete team in football, offense, defense, special teams. And I know this is the proverbial must-win game for the Rams. There's no such thing, because 31 of the 32 NFL teams will lose the game they must win this year. So that's never been a motivator for me. Buffalo traveled west to Seattle a few weeks ago. Seattle was a trendy play. Buffalo smacked them around. You brought up, there's a new reality. There's one team they get to buy this year. These are going to be Kansas City or Buffalo. Buffalo doesn't want to falter. And they got to go to Detroit in a couple weeks. So I could only lean Buffalo in this spot. I think it's a mismatch. Now, you put two NFL games, teams on the field at any given Sunday. We know what Burt Bell said, but I feel like it's a mismatch.
I believe this line opened at 4.5 and now is down to 3.5. Is that correct?
That's right.
And the over's gone up. Now, did it go up at half a point?
The over's 50.
Is this sharp money on the dog?
There's some sharp guys on the plus four.
It feels like a math play.
Plus four minus 05 I seen hit earlier. Yeah, solid 3.5, even minus 3, minus 25 at the offshore spots.
Is it a trendy pick?
I can't bet plus 3.5 now. I know there was fours out there reduced juice. I couldn't do it.
Rams get a lot of love. They get too much love in the betting markets, for my money.
You brought up Chicago and San Francisco. You said, is San Francisco done? Put a fork in them?
I think they're done. I think they had trouble in the offseason where players wanted to be traded, players wanted to have a new contract. All that stuff didn't work out. CMC misses the first part of the year, comes back, plays a little bit, gets hurt. Now he's out for the season. They got other players hurt as well. You know, they got some older players there. There was, for that type of team, that's a Super Bowl team, or they're done. And they're not going to make the Super Bowl. They're not even going to win that division. And I think they're toast.
What about Bernie?
I can't remember when I've been more fooled. They beat the Jets like a rented mule early on in the year. And since then, you know, no CMC, like you said. Brandon Ayuk gets paid, gets hurt. And it's just one of those years where they're regressing back to the mean.
Well, how about the issues with Shanahan? You talk about some bad coaches. I've seen enough of this guy. I mean, brilliant offensive mind, but, you know, continue to blow these games left and right. That's taken a toll on this team. When you have these double-digit leads against the division rivals and you can't close the deal, I think that's been some of the biggest attrition and injuries as well. We don't know Boza or Williams is going to play. You have a quarterback with a banged-up shoulder as well. With that said, boy, and I really want to play the Bears this week. I don't know if this line is fair. I mean, you had Chicago catching 10 last week at Detroit. You know, now it's 4 at San Francisco. So I really want to bet Chicago. I haven't got there yet. I'll say this, and you know, you kind of get that bump in the NFL. I mean, there's no question the Bears wanted a new coach. They wanted that guy fired. So you expect a little bump here from the Bears. The problem I have with the Bears is they are so fundamentally poorly coached that it's just hard to turn that stuff around in a week, you know, with kind of a rah-rah new head coach. You know, you watch their offensive line play. It's a bit atrocious. It's just fundamentally poor. Hard to turn that around in a short amount of time.
Bernie, you like the Bears?
You talk about Shanahan losing. I mean, Super Bowl, he was offensive coordinator for Atlanta, up 28-3, blew the game. That's one. Then the next two times when they played Kansas City, he was leading in the fourth quarter. Garoppolo, he blew those games. He has a tendency, he's a script guy.
The thing is, Jim,
he can't think outside the box.
Right, I had a big bet on San Francisco the first Kansas City game, Super Bowl game. And he blew that game before halftime. He wasn't aggressive. And you have to remember, he's a brilliant offensive guy. He has all these offensive weapons. So be aggressive with the players and the team that you have. Don't be punting and giving the other team chances. But I remember reading his quotes after that game. It was a little bit like Eberflus for the Bears, that didn't acknowledge the wrongs that he had, and he keeps making these same mistakes over and over. It's a bad coaching job right now.
Just in his DNA, right?
Aaron just brought it up. I can't get my mind around that number.
Yeah, it's short.
I mean, look at the other road Bear games the Bears have played on the road. You're getting a number that short. I mean, who are they playing, Georgia Tech? I don't like anything about this Bears team at all.
The Bears don't even know about their own team.
Everybody this time of year, I mean, you're going to the playoffs or you're not going to the playoffs, but all these players are playing for their jobs. So, and not everybody has long-term contracts.
Let's go back to 50 minutes ago ever so quickly. You brought up Caleb Williams and Matt Eberflus. And I said on my show Friday night, I said, it was 90% Eberflus' fault and 90% Caleb Williams' fault. You're the field general. Quarterback's a position you play with your eyes, okay? Go back and watch the highlight. Look at Caleb Williams' eyes. He looks like he's in the mall parking lot, can't find his car. And the clock is ticking, 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 and Eberflus is over there looking like Barney Rubble. And what is going on? But if you're the field general, make a decision. Snap the ball, spike it, call time. Do something.
I thought they may not get it snapped before the clock ran out. I was thinking this could go down to zero before it could happen.
He made Mike McCarthy look good, and that's not easy to do. So I have no faith in Caleb Williams. If you want him in a punt, pass, and kick competition, knock yourself out.
Ray, you got a question?
I think his eyes match his fingernails very well. But real quick, just to touch on that, like you said, Shanahan is brilliant, you know, and I'm pretty good at what I do. You will comment, hang on. Listen, you sell out. When you're really good at something in situations, you have to sell out, like the blitz or in life, right? You leave yourself vulnerable. But I think this week with Shanahan, I think he realizes, I don't know if he thinks it's over, he's a fighter. I think that the scenarios after weighing them out, you have to take the Bears. You don't have to do anything. The Bears with the 4 is the better bet, because if Chicago does decide to run around going nuts, they do try to prove themselves. There's guys on the teams with contracts. Shanahan, they get up. Shanahan might pull players and be like, you know what? I'm not. I'm going to let this one ride out.
I'm not involved in the game for the record.
Yeah, I'm not touching the game, but I do like the Bears plus four. If I had to go that way, I think I would imagine.
Any other questions from the audience? No other questions?
I have to acknowledge that we have a Dallas Cowboy championship belt over here to the right.
I didn't even know they made such a belt.
Good friend of mine. Well, they'll never have one.
This is the only title they're getting anytime soon. Right here.
Jim, let me go back to you. Is there any other games this week we haven't hit on that you like?
Oh, boy. Yes. You know, Seattle and Arizona is a big game. They're playing for that division. And we were just talking about the Rams. We were talking about the Niners. We might as well talk about these two guys because these two teams are the likely winners. One of these teams likely winners of this division. I like the way Carolina's playing. I like their coach, what he's done. And yeah, they turned the ball over last week, but they played pretty damn good at the Vikings. Not an easy place to play. And if it wasn't for Donald coming in the second half and just lighting it up, but they turned the ball over a little too much, and Murray does that. That they're talented, they're home, they got revenge from an earlier loss in Seattle in some inclement weather. I don't like laying 2.5. I bet the money line on Arizona.
There's a game I actually like a lot we haven't even brought up.
It's Which one?
I like these under-the-radar games. Let's take a look at the Tennessee Titans. Team that clearly can't find their ass with both hands. 0-5 against the number at home this year, and they've been a dog every time. Now you dress them up as a 4-point favorite, but you can't get 4 anymore. It's down to 3.5. Pesky Jacksonville comes in. I actually like Mac Jones. I'll give my reasons later after the show. And all of a sudden now, Tennessee's laying points, and I think they're 1-8 the last time they've laid points against anybody. So I grabbed Jacksonville plus the 4 earlier in the week.
Aaron, any other games?
I'm going with what Jim was talking about with Arizona. I am going to bet Arizona. A small bet for Arizona. I do like the total a little bit better. I played that game under the total. And, you know, Seattle, again, with a defensive head coach, really banged up from a defensive standpoint to start the year and having some issues with stopping anybody, really. But then they had their bye week. And they've come out of their bye week and played really well defensively, including allowing 6 points to Arizona at home. Last week, the Jets were a little bit fluky to get to 21. Had a good game. They held San Francisco down out of the bye as well. So, you know, it's a defense that's improving, getting better, figuring out this system. And with that said, this Arizona defense has been the most underrated unit in the NFL all season. They've been tremendous, underrated. You saw it last week against Minnesota. I mean, Minnesota didn't cross 300 yards of offense. They let down at the end of the game, but they've been very good. Two head coaches that are defensive guys, two quarterbacks that I don't exactly trust to score touchdowns in the end with how they've played so far this year. So I bet it under. I do have a small bet on Arizona.
You got to love what Jonathan Gannon has done with that team and the culture at Arizona.
I mean, they certainly from a talent perspective, they've overachieved, and on that defensive side of the football.
Bernie, let me ask you a question, because I normally don't talk about teams that are on a bye week, but I'm curious to hear from all three of you guys on the Baltimore Ravens. They seem like you can't figure them out. As soon as you think they're going to be really good, they lose, they drop a game. Are they one of the top five teams that can still make the Super Bowl, or is that gone?
I suppose they do have Mr. October, Lamar Jackson. He's phenomenal in October. But when it matters in January, call me when they do something that matters. On paper, yeah, but they won't. They'll do it again. They're an 8-5 team. Bill Parcells said it right. Best. You are what your record says you are.
I'm not
a Baltimore guy.
Going to the Giants when they come out of the bye week.
Yeah, you know, I've had Baltimore rated as my top power rated team in the NFL for quite some time this year. But you know, as I'll talk about, kind of like the NBA now, NFL, you have to have kind of two ideas and two sets of power ratings. You have to have a regular season and you have to have a postseason. You know, right now Kansas City is underachieved. You know, they're not a high power rating team. They're probably not even a top five power rated team in the NFL. But you know, when the playoffs start, you better move them and you better put them there because they know how to win games when the point spreads are, you know, pick them or a field goal. So, yeah, until you see it with this Baltimore team, it's hard to, you know, say they are. I mean, they're definitely a Super Bowl contender, but Super Bowl favorite. And then, you know, I haven't even mentioned the kicking problem that you're going to have here in the playoffs with this team. So we'll see if they figure that out over the bye.
If I could just say one thing, clearly, power ratings with their offensive firepower, yards per play, yards, the points, no argument there. There's an old saying in sports, can you be great when the situation demands greatness? And that one moment where the heat gets hot and it's hard to breathe and the whole world's watching, I've yet to see from Lamar Jackson.
Agreed. He blows a lot of big games, whether it's playoffs or regular season. He just doesn't get it. But, you know, I have to go to the coaching side of this a little bit. The offensive coordinator there, I have a question of how he played last year against Kansas City.
Right.
And a couple games this year. They have a tremendous rushing attack with Henry and Jackson. And why the hell would you have a game where you only give Henry the ball 13 times?
You know, Casey Stengel.
What kind of an offensive coordinator does that when that is your power game?
The New York Yankees won 9 World Series in the 50s and in the 60s, I don't know, like 12 years. Casey Stengel once said, teams can't beat the Yankees because they get stuck staring at the pinstripes. This guy gets on the field and sees that red helmet with Andy Reid over on the side, much the same way with Ryan Day in Michigan. They're human. Something's going on between the ears there. I'm convinced of it.
I mean, the remaining schedule are going to go to the Giants, and they got the Steelers at home. Then they're going to Texas, and they finish with Cleveland at home. I mean, their schedule favors them. But as they've been shown before, they could drop one to anybody. You know,
they're going to play in the playoffs. I mean, the question is, what do they do when they get there?
Right. Exactly. Let's end with this, Jim, and then we'll get final thoughts from everybody, and then I'm going to go have one of these mistletoe misdemeanors with Crown Royal and sugar and blood orange liqueur and start my holiday season going right now. But going forward, you've talked about coaching so much, and I'm big on coaching and making decisions on when you're going to lay money at. I'm big on coaching. How do you then bet against Andy Reid?
I mean, he goes back to Philadelphia when he was there and he had McNabb and all that. I mean, this guy's he's a real good coach. Mm-hmm. But, you know, like this week, he's going up against Harbaugh, who's another really good coach, but he's got a more talented team. But overall, and then you have to look at the other side of the ball. Spags is a hell of a defensive coordinator. People don't talk about that much. When last year, when they were playing the Niners in the Super Bowl, Mike Scali and I were up here and we analyzed that game. And the reason we came down to liking Kansas City was Spagnuolo. He knows how to stop you. He knows how to make adjustments in game. It's not just Andy Reid. He has a great defensive coordinator. And give him, Andy Reid, the credit for hiring him. Because this guy tried to be a head coach. His talent is at that level. He's a great defensive coordinator. When you look at that, that's going to win the games a lot.
Bernie or Aaron, do you guys look at head coaches before making laying money? Because I always do.
I think you always have to keep it in mind. And you kind of power rate your teams and et cetera. Like you say, if you've been betting against Andy Reid in the playoffs or Patrick Mahomes in the playoffs, you've lost money for a fact. So, yeah, if you're trying to make money at this, if you don't understand the coaches, you're gonna have a hard time.
Is that the goal?
It's a great point, Aaron. I mean, it's not the be all end all, but it's absolutely a factor. And my final thought, I can't believe we've made it 48 minutes and not brought up the New York Jets. They're catching, I think, 6 in Miami this week. What's the number, guy?
Six.
There's an interesting stat about the Dolphins. They're like 15-4 in their last 19 home games, and they're laying 6 points or more. And I haven't fired on the game, but any thoughts on that game? You might look up in the fourth quarter, and it's 31-13. Dolphins.
I bet the Dolphins.
Thank you.
Right. Well, you. I mean, we'll see. Oh, you can take me on Sunday.
You can't. How can you make a case for the Jets?
I mean, the Jets. I bet the Jets last week. And off their bye, they played well. And I mean, just again, talk about coaching
and
your fundamentals. I mean, penalty after penalty, mistake after mistake. We're up by 14. Rodgers has the pick six. They're banged up as well. Gardner, I don't think, is going to play. The offensive line, I was kind of waiting to see what was going to happen with Rodgers. I thought maybe they would bench him, but
they won't.
And I'm not sold on McDaniels here in the Dolphins either, with that said, but they are better at home. They have offensive firepower, and it's a massive game for them where the Jets are just playing out the street.
Here's the thing on coaching. When Jimmy Johnson took over the Cowboys in 1989, he set the tone and changed the culture instantly. He cut a second or third round draft choice running back in the preseason when he fumbled. He called the kid in, he said, "Son, I'm going to give you a chance to never lose a game for the Dallas Cowboys again. You're fired." And the whole organization saw it. Whatever's been going on in New York this year, and Weeb Eubank ain't walking through that door. Rex Ryan might, but Weeb Eubank ain't. It's been enabled. They've allowed these same mistakes over and over and over again. Blown assignments, penalties, turnovers, bad port, open field tackling, non-existent. They've enabled that behavior. There's your coaching angle.
Is it the coach in that spot, or can you start with the owner?
Yeah, I think that's what you...
Maybe it's a top-down problem. Hire the wrong people, get it interfered too much.
Well, they told us all we needed was a quarterback. They won 7 games last year with Zach Wilson. They got an elite defense. Where did you have their defense heading into the year? Number two?
You had to put them in certainly top five, but I mean, yeah.
Well, they had everything in place. You're bringing your quarterback.
They had solid. They had solid there. Once they fired solid, the defense went downhill.
That's right.
And even though he was the head coach,
that's right.
He had some effect on that defense.
Well, he had pretty good defenses in San Francisco. He gets some credit for that.
That's damn right. Damn right.
Any final comments or questions from the audience?
You guys going to talk about the Monday night game?
Yes, I want to do that.
Yeah, please do.
I want to do that. Jerry Jones, my favorite owner in the whole.
You know, speaking of owners, running the show.
Well, we have to go from the Jets to Dallas to talk about ownership. Dallas, I mean, I don't know. CeeDee Lamb, is he going to play? They're down to the second quarterback. I mean, I don't know. And they're playing the Bengals, who no one, if the Bengals play like they can play in offense, how the hell are you going to score enough points to keep up with them? Because nobody stops them. But then again, they can't stop anybody. I bet the game over. I just figure if both teams are, I could score against the Bengals defense. It's a high school defense.
Well, I've had a rule of thumb over the years. Whenever you have a team after November that has an under 500 record and they're laying points on the road, I don't feel real good about laying wood on the road when I got an under 500 team. So I might throw half a unit on Dallas or piece of money, depending on what. You know, it's on TV, we got to bet it, right? Those are the rules. I could not back Cincinnati because they burned me too many times this year. Okay. They fooled me. Coaching, I don't mind Zach Taylor. I love Lou Anarumo. Jesse Bates leaves, the whole defense goes to hell.
The Bengals have probably knocked all the players out of the survival pool because, they just keep losing.
They fooled me. They got plenty of me. They lost money on my money between them and Tennessee. Jesus, I'm not going to be able to have that private plane now with 24-hour access.
Everybody, hang on to your tickets. We'll announce the winners of the bottles of wine that have been donated by J-Lore Winery, so we'll do that after we close out the show. Aaron Redding, thank you for coming on the show.
Yes, thanks for having me.
Bernie Fredo, thank you for coming on the show. You and I will talk more as we get done. And you'll always be on the show, so I'll see you next week with our guest. I know Ray LaMarca is going to be joining us again next week on the panel. I don't know who else. Maybe Crack Man. Maybe we'll grab Crack Man and get him on the show next week.
I'm not going on with him.
I'll be back December 2nd. January 2nd.
You're back here on January 2nd?
I am, yeah.
Perfect. I'll see you then, and we'll see everybody next week
at
noon. Good luck on your bets, everybody, and we'll see you next Thursday here at Dom DeMarco's Pizzeria and Wine Bar. Of course, Jim Feist. My name is Tommy Canella.